बिस्मिल्लाहिर्रहमानिर्रहीम, अस्सलाम वालेकुम। लेक्चर 5, पोइट्री 1, कोर्स कोड 403। लेट्स फर्स्ट हैव अ लुक एट द लेक्चर 4। वी डिस्कस सम ऑफ द कैरेक्टर्स, वी हैड सर्टेन इंट्रोडक्शन। चौसर डिस्क्राइब द सीन, द सीजन, स्प्रिंग सीजन पर्टिकुलरली, एज स्प्रिंग इज सिम्बॉलिक ऑफ लाइफ, इट गिव्स न्यू एनर्जी, इट गिव्स पावर, स्ट्रेंथ, विगर। देन लेटर ऑन द होस्ट कम्स अप टू ऑन टू डिस्क ही continues his description of the characters, the different pilgrims. First of all, we had the introduction with the knight, who is a very important character. He is the role model, he is an ideal character. He starts with that probably because of the reason that he holds a high social rank. Then his character is followed by his son, the squire. His description is there. Then later on we have the yeoman's character, who is in the service of the knight. And we have the introduction to the first church character, the prioress. Then another character from the church, the monk, the friar. Then we had the man of law, the lawyer, the Franklin, the country young man, his character was there. The five members of the guild were there, and the Oxford clerk, another important ideal character, because he also is doing his work very sincerely, truthfully, the way he is supposed to do all these things. Then there is the merchant's character. Finally, we had the cook's character. Now, all these characters, they had certain characteristics, certain traits. Their attitude towards work, towards the society, was different. So it is very important. These the lines of the way Chaucer depicts their characters, it's not very difficult. It just gives he just describes what they are holding and what is the condition of the things and their dresses, all these things, in order to give us an idea that what was their outlook of life, how they perceived things. ताकि हमें उससे ये पता चले कि ये जो different लोग, जो different societies को, कुछ upper class को reflect कर रहे हैं, कुछ social class को, कुछ religious category को कर रहे हैं, तो इन लोगों के पहनना इनका कैसा है, इनके पास क्या क्या चीज़ें हैं और वो किस तरह की हैं, और वो वर्ल्डली परसूट्स में कितने इन्वॉल्व हैं, उनको या उनके जो नॉलेज है या इंटरेस्ट है वो किस तरह का है, वो क्या चीज़, किस चीज़ को प्रेफर करते हैं, एंड व्हाट दे ऑट टू डू एट द सेम टाइम डेफिनेटली ही इज़ इंटरेस्टेड इन, उनको क्या करना चाहिए बिकॉज ऑफ देयर सोशल स्टेटस, बिकॉज दे हैव अ सोशल स्टैंडिंग, उनकी एक पोजीशन है. फॉर एग्जांपल, इफ द पर्सन बिलोंगिंग टू द चर्च हैज गॉट सर्टन स्टेटस, मे बी अ फ्रायर और अ मॉन्क, ही हैज सर्टन रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटीज अटैच टू इट, और उन रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटीज की वजह से उस पर कुछ, उससे कुछ एक्सपेक्टेशंस हैं. आर दे रियली फुलफिलिंग दैट? And along with those expectations, they are supposed to do things in a certain manner, and whether they are really doing those things. So basically, the prologue to the Canterbury Tales is based on the major part of it is based on the description of these characters, जिसमें हमें 14th सेंचुरी के बारे में पता चलता है. तो मेजर पोर्शन जो इसमें प्रोलॉग टू द कैंटरबरी टेल्स में है, उसमें हमें कैरेक्टर्स की डिस्क्रिप्शन पता चलती है, हमें उनके इंटरेस्ट का पता चलता है, वो क्या कर रहे हैं, किस तरीके से कर रहे हैं, वो क्या करना चाहते हैं सोसाइटी में, और जो उनका सोशल रैंकिंग है, जो उनका सोशल उनका सेटअप है, उसमें उनको क्या करना चाहिए, वो जिस रैंक पर फाइज हैं उससे उनसे क्या एक्सपेक्टेशंस हैं, उनसे उन क्या सपोज किया जाता है कि उनको वो काम किस तरीके से करना चाहिए. और इसमें बहुत कम कैरेक्टर्स हैं जो कि आइडियल कैरेक्टर्स हैं, बहुत कम कैरेक्टर्स हैं. अदरवाइज मोस्ट ऑफ देम are corrupt. As I told you in the beginning, that probably these characters are they are lifelike characters. He is depicting the correct people as they are. He has given a realistic picture of the society. He has narrated these portraits in such a way, the descriptions of these pilgrims in such a way, that it is lifelike. A reader feels that he is talking about his society. The poet, the writer, is talking about his particular society in which he is living. Even at present, if you look around us, we will find number of people like this, who have the material pursuits, they the way they are dressed, I mean the kind of thing, definitely certain things have changed, like the knighthood or the use of a dagger or the use of a sword, it's no more around. because of the mechanical, industrial and nuclear revolution. But definitely other than that, the kinds of interest people have, the perception towards life, that is the same. That has not changed. The kind of dress up they have, how they behave in different situations. So these things, those descriptions, they are similar. They are somewhat real, and they are real not only in the 14th century, they stand real even today. Okay, today we will begin with the character of a shipman. We have the description of the shipman. There was a shipman wanting fur by Westay. For aught I would, he was of Dartmouth. That there was a shipman with them. He lived in a far off land. The narrator says that as he knew that he lived in Dartmouth. He lived in Dartmouth. He rode upon a rounds. Rounds is a horse, is a type of horse. He rode upon a horse as he quoth. Quoth is could. He rode as he could. He rode upon a horse as he could. In a gown of felding to the knee, a dagger hanging on a lass had he, about his neck, under his arm, adorn. Adorn is hanging. So what he had, he rode upon a horse as he could, and in his gown he had the gown was made up of the rough woolen cloth, and it reached his knees. The length of the gown was till the knees, and he had a dagger hanging under his arm. It was around his neck, under his arm, and it was hanging on a lace. And so this is the description, the things that the shipman was carrying, that he belonged to the far off land. The hoote summer had made his hue all brown. So the hot summer season had made all his color brown. And certainly he was a good fellow. Full many a draught of wine had he draw. Fro Brodeck's ward, while that chapman sleep, of nice conscience took he no keep. So the hot summer had made his color all brown, and certainly he was a good fellow. Now he was a good fellow. Right after that, he is telling some incident. He is saying that many times what happened, basically in those days it was a custom to travel once in a year to Bordeaux to bring wine. So when those merchants, they were traveling to Bordeaux, he took, when those merchants, they used to sleep, he took wine from them without telling them. So he said that he had nice conscience, that he did not take any care of conscience. He did not believe in that. He did not give any importance to his conscience. And when those merchants, they were asleep, he took wine without asking them. If that he fought, and had he higher horn, by water he sent them home to every lawn. So if he had fight with anyone, and had the higher horn, and if he had the higher hand, and if he is the one who was the right one, or if he is the one who is the strong out of the two contestants, what he will do, he would send his prisoners, or he would send the other person with whom he had fought, he would send the person into the water. So he is ironically saying here that by water he sent him home to every land, that he would send the prisoner, he would send the person, his rival, to the home by throwing him into the sea. But of his craft to reckon well his tides, his streams and his dongers, him besides, his Hebrew and his moon, his lodminage, there was a known switch such hold to Carthage. So he had been to different places. He had the experience, he had that skill to travel to different parts of the world. And it was not, he was a very skilled shipman. He had traveled to a large number of places, and he had even been to the places from Yorkshire to the north coast of Africa. Hardly he was and ways to undertake. With many a tempest had his bed been shake. He knew all the heavens as they were, for fro Gutlon to the Cape of Fentisere, and every crack in Britain and in Spain, his barge ye clapped was the Madeline. Now, barge ye clapped means his ship was called Madeline. So hardly he would undertake. His voyage to a number of places. He had been to a number of places. His beard has been shaken. It had been. It has shed its hair. He knew all the places. Heavens, basically, here refers to all the beautiful places that have got all the riches, the worldly riches. He knew all of those places, and he had visited all those places from the Cape of Finisterre and every island of the Britain and Spain, and he had been to all these places, and his ship was called Madeleine. So he knew all these places because he had been there. He was aware of all these beautiful places on the earth. With us there was a doctor of physics. So next we have a doctor of medicine. He was a doctor of physics, a doctor of medicine as well. So in all his world, nay was the known him like. There was no one in all the world like him to speak of physic and surgery. So there was no comparison of him in the field of physics or surgery. His skill, his craft was unsurpassable. कोई भी उसकी स्किल को उसके जो काम है उसको मैच नहीं कर सकता था. फॉर ही वॉज ग्राउंडेड इन एस्ट्रोनॉमी. सो ही वॉज वेल वर्स्ड इन द फील्ड ऑफ एस्ट्रोनॉमी. सो ही वॉच्ड हिज पेशेंट्स वेरी वेल इन आवर्स थ्रू दिस नेचुरल मैजिक. सो इट वॉज नॉट ओनली ही वॉज नॉट ओनली द डॉक्टर ऑफ फिजिक्स. ही हैड द ग्रेट नॉलेज ऑफ एस्ट्रोनॉमी एज वेल, एंड ही न्यू द कॉजेज ऑफ ऑल द डिजीजेज. सो ही His patients were under observation through, and he read them very carefully. He paid them great heed and in the natural magic of astronomy. Well could he fortunen the ascendant of his images for his patient. He knew the cause of every malady. Malady is the disease, illness. Were it of hot or cool or moist or dry, and where they engendered or of what humor. He was a very perfect practitioner. He was a very perfect practitioner. Practitioner is a practitioner. So he could tell the fortune of his by the rise and fall of the moon and stars. He could tell his patients about through those images. He could tell the fortune of his patients, and he knew the causes of every disease, and he knew that whether it was because of the hot or cold or moisture and the dryness, and what is the cause of those illnesses. Humor, basically, there are four humors which are believed to make up life, and that is hot, cold, moist and dry. These four are the important ingredients. If there is any one of these is less or greater in degree, there is illness, or the person is ill, or any other sort of problem might be there. So it is because of the imbalance of these humors that these diseases they are caused. He was a very perfect practitioner. He was a perfect practitioner. The cause ye know of his harm the rooted, and on he yaf the sick man his booty. Now he said that in the previous line, he just said that he was a perfect practitioner. He was a perfect practitioner. Why? He is telling the reason now that why he was a perfect practitioner, because he did not experimented upon his patients. He of his harm, the root, he spared them of the drawbacks, of the disadvantages of his practice. Anon he yaf the sick man his bhute, full ready had he his apothecaries to send him drugges and his litores, for each of them made udar for two wine, his friendship nest net new to begin. So he would give the sick men the remedy, he would tell them the reason, and he was his all medicines, they were all ready for him. And he was not the one who would practice upon his patients, because this is the age of experimentation and doctors. He was not that sort of experimenter. He would keep the patient under observation, observe him, and he would take help also from astronomy, and by studying the person's stars very carefully and the movement of those stars, he would treat the patient. And all his patients, they were they had a good friendship with him, and it was not new to begin that way. It was not the beginning of the friend, new beginning of the friendship. Well knew he the old Aesculapius, Dioscorides, and eke Rufus, old Hippocras, Heli and Galen, Serapion, Rhazes, and Avicen, Averroes, Damasian, and Constantine, Bernard, Gaddesden, and Gilbertine. Now all these are the important people in the field of medicine in different eras. So it is not that he was not aware of them. He knew, he had the good idea, he knew about, he knew well, he had the full knowledge about them all. They have been the famous people in the field of medicine and during different eras. So he knew them all very well. Of his diet, so it's not that he is only concerned with the diseases and their treatments. He is also aware of the field, of the history, the development of this field of medicine. Of his diet, measurable was he. So earlier we just talked about his field, that he was a doctor, and he how did he treat his patients, and his knowledge about that subject. Now coming to his personal habits, of his diet, measurable was he. Measurable is very careful, very limited. He took very limited diet, for it was of no superfluity, that he was not superfluous. He did not use more than was needed. He was very cautious, very careful in the use of his in the use of his diet. He ate very little. But of great nourishing and digestible, his study was but little on the Bible. So whatever he ate, that was not superfluous, that was little measurable, that was limited, but that was nourishing and digestible. So being a doctor, he would always choose the food item that was nourishing and that was digestible for him. His study was but little on the Bible. So talking about the religious side of it, he had very little knowledge about the Bible, which is the holy book, the scriptures. In sanguine and in purse he clad was all. Clad is dressed, sanguine is red, purse is blue. So in blue and red he was dressed, lined with taffeta and with sandal. So देवर लाइनिंग्स ऑफ द कॉस्टली सिल्क टेफ्टा एंड सैंडल दीज आर दी कॉस्टली सिल्क एंड देर वॉज लाइनिंग ऑफ दीज कॉस्टली सिल्क ऑन हिज ड्रेस इट वॉज द ड्रेस वॉज रेड एंड ब्लू एंड इट हैड लाइनिंग ऑफ कॉस्टली सिल्क ऑन इट एंड येट ही वॉज बट ईजी ऑफ डिस्पेंस He was easy of dispense means he was not very extravagant. He was economical in his spending or buying things. So he was very economical in his routine, in his matters of spending money. So he kept it that he ran in pestilence. So whatever he earned during the days of the plague, pestilence is the plague. In introduction, I mentioned about the Black Death, probably from 1348-49, we talked about the plague, the Black Death. So whatever he had earned during the days of the plague, he had kept some of it, he had spared it. For gold in physic is a cordial, therefore he loved gold in special. So once again, since he is a worldly man, he is a materialistic person, he also loved gold and he spared some money that he said he had earned during the days of the Black Death, during the days of the plague. And since here it says that for gold in physic is a cordial. Now, how they are cordial, what is the link? Basically, in metaphysics, the chemists, alchemists, they believe, the philosophers, they believe that we can turn the baser metals into gold. So there is that strong connection of physics and gold. So this is the reason he said that since there is a connection of physics and gold, and he is the doctor of physics, he is the doctor of surgery and medicine, the narrator says that since there is a strong connection of physics and gold, so he also loved it, and he especially loved it. Next, we have the character of wife of Bath. She was a very good character, and very important character in the sense that she is a representative lady, the way ladies used to behave in those days. She is called the wife of Bath. She is not the wife of the person. Basically, it was the name of the place. Bath is a place. And she was Samdal deaf. Now the narrator feels sorry for her that she was somewhat deaf from 1 year, and that was scathe of cloth making. She had such an hound, she passed him of Ypres and of Gaunt, and in all the parish with name was there known that to the offering before her should gone. She had certain characteristics. She had the skill of making a cloth, and no one else could do that. And not even the Cypress and the Gaunt, they even could not do that. So she had this skill, she had this extraordinary craft that she could make the finest cloth, and nobody else could excel her, nobody else could make a cloth like hers. In the village, there was no one who could give offering before her, or who would give the charity or the alms before her. And if there did, now if there was anybody who could give it before her, certain so Ruth was she. Ruth is angry, so she would be very angry on that. Nobody else could give anything, any offering before her, but if somebody did that, she would be very angry that she was out of all charity, that she would forget all charity. So this is something ironical here, something humorous, that if she would be all good, she would give lots of charity, nobody else can be compared to her offerings in the church, but if somebody else offered before her, she would forget all that charity and she would be angry on that. Her coverchiefs full fine worn of ground, I doste swear that they weighed 10 pound, that on a Sunday worn upon her head. Now talking about her dress, that the coverchief, the cloth with which she covered her head, it was of fine cloth, and narrator, he believes that he says that I swear that it would weigh if it is weighed, it would be 10 pounds. And she used to wear this kerchief on her head on Sundays in the services. So she is charitable, she gives charity, and she has the skill, she has the extraordinary craft that she can make fine cloth that nobody else in the town can do that. She can give lots of charity, but she would be angry if somebody else did that before her. And the kerchief or the handkerchief with which she covered her head on Sundays in the services, that would weigh 10 pounds. Her husband Warren of fine scarlet reed, full straight, tied, and shoes full, moist and new. Blood was her face, and fair and reed of hue. She was a worthy woman all her life. So her horse was fine scarlet red, and she had shoes that were straight tied, and they were very soft and they were new. Her face was reddish, it was like blood, and it was fair, and it was red of hue, that the color of it was more of red. She was a worthy woman all her life. Now, after having some part of her character, some part of her description, the skills or the interest that she had, she was a worthy woman. Once again, the use of the worthy here is humorous, it's ironical that she was a worthy woman all her life, because the description that is going to come, that will follow this one, we will come to know about her real character, that what type of lady she was, because so far we know that what she would do if somebody else gave charity before her, she would become angry. So that means she is an ill-tempered lady who would mind if somebody did something good before her. She was very careful about her outer appearance. She was careful about her clothes and dressing and her facial features also. Now, husbands at church, though she had five. She was married five times. She had five husbands without an other company in youth. Without that means in addition to, so in youth she had certain other affairs also, in addition to these she had five husbands. With thereof needeth not to speak as Nodi. Now the narrator says that at this place, at this moment, I should not talk about such type of things. I should not give any further details. I should not speak about certain things because it's not good, because she is a pilgrimage now. She is a pilgrim now. She is proceeding on the pilgrimage. So I should not talk about such things. But he has told, he has given a clue the type of life she has spent, that she has had married five times. She had five husbands. And in addition to this, she had some affairs also in her youth. And thrice had she been at Jerusalem. So she has visited Jerusalem thrice in her life. She had passed many a strange stream at Rome. She had passed many a strange stream at Rome. She had been and at Boulogne, in Galles, at St. James, and at Cologne. She could much of wandering by the way, get toth was she soothly for to say. She had been to a number of places. She loved visiting different shrines and the holy places. She had been to Jerusalem thrice. Then she had passed a number of strange lands, and she had been to all those places. She had been to Rome. She had been to Boulogne, where there is an image of a virgin. Now, this is something contrary to her character. She had a lot of affairs in her youth, and moreover, she married five times, so she is not a virgin. I mean, she is not somebody who had that model of a virgin. So, but she had been to a shrine where there is an image of a virgin. In Galles at St. James, which is in Galicia, which is situated in Spain, and at Cologne, and she could much of wandering by the way. She had been to Cologne, where there are the tombs of three knights from the east. So she had visited a lot of places all her life. Now, finally, in this line, it says gat-toothed. Gat-toothed, it is believed that a person who has gap in his teeth is likely to travel a lot in his life. Soothly for to say. So when she was very young, it was believed that since she has gap in her teeth, so she would be a great traveler. She would be visiting a lot of places. Upon an ambler, easily she sat. She would sit on a horse which walked very smoothly, wimpled well, and on her head an hat as broad as is a buckler or a targe. A buckler or a targe is a small shield, a fat mantle about her hips, large, a foot mantle is a kind of skirt, outer skirt that she was wearing, and on her feet a pair of spurs sharp. So she was having a pair of spurs in her feet. In fellowship well could she laugh and carp. Carp is to talk. In the company of all these pilgrims, she would laugh and she would talk a lot. So she knew how to do that. She knew how to move about with people and how to talk and how to have that chit chat. So she is the kind of lady who knew how to do all that, how to sit in the company, how to laugh, how to talk, and how to behave. So she was not a shy lady at all. Of Remedies of Love, she knew perchance. She had read that. It is the name of a book which has been translated into English, and she had probably read that book. For she could of that art the old dons. Now, she could. She knew that ancient game of making love. She had the art and she had the skill of playing that game. She knew how to play that. So far, we come to know about her married life, that she had been married 5 times, and then we come to know about her dressing, that she could sit on a horse that would walk very smoothly, and she was well dressed. She was wearing a hat and a wimple, and she was having a small shield also, and she was wearing a small outer skirt around her body, and she was wearing a pair of spurs that were very sharp, and she knew how to move about in the company. A good man was there of religion. Now, after wife of Bath, we have got a very important character here, parson, and was a poor parson of the town. T-O-U-N, this is the modern English equivalent of T-O-W-N, town. Now, poor parson, he was a good man. He was a good man of religion. He belonged to the church, and he was a poor parson of the town. But rich he was of holy thought and work. He possessed good and sacred thoughts and work, because he was not corrupt. So that is why he says that he is rich. He is poor, but at the same time he calls him rich on the basis of his knowledge and his work. His knowledge, his work, and his thinking. He was also a learned man, a clerk. So he was a learned man, and he had read lots of books. So he was concerned with his duty as well. That Christ's gospel truly world preach, his parishioners devoutly would he teach. What he would teach? He was not only himself a learned man, he was a learned man himself. He would teach, he would preach truly the gospel of the Christ, which has been without any alterations in it. So he would very truly, very sincerely preach the gospel, the Bible of the Christ, and his parishioners, the people who would come to him, the people living in the surrounding areas in the town, he would very sincerely, very devotedly, he would teach them. Began he was and wondered diligent. Diligent is hardworking. He is a very hardworking man. Benign he was kind and hardworking. सो दिस इज हिज कैरेक्टर क्वालिटी दैट ही वॉज काइंड एंड ही वॉज वेरी हार्ड वर्किंग मैन एंड इन इन एडवर्सिटी फुल पेशेंट इन द बैड टाइम्स इन द टाइम्स ऑफ डिफिकल्टी इन द टाइम ऑफ मिसफॉर्चून ही वॉज वेरी पेशेंट एंड सच ही वॉज ये प्रेव्ड ऑफ्ट सिदे एंड एट मैनी ओकेजन्स ही प्रूव्ड himself to be patient in the times of misfortunes also, but rather would he even out of doubt unto his poor parishioners about of his offering and eke of his substance he could in little thing have sufficiency. Tithe refers to the 10th part of the income that a person earns. He has to give away the 10th part of the income to the for the betterment of the poor people. So whatever you earn or whatever the land or whatever the earning you get from the land, you are supposed to give the 10th part of it as for the betterment of the society. But rather would he yevan, yevan is give out of doubt. So without any doubt, he would happily give give away that part of the money, that 10th part of the of his income unto his poor parishioners about of his offering and eke of his substance. So he would offer and he could in little thing have sufficiency. So he had the satisfaction because whatever would be left with him after giving away all that he had to, he would be satisfied with whatever he is left with. So he was satisfied even with the little possible. Wide was his parish and houses fair asunder. So his the area of his parish, the area of his control, that was wide, that was a large area, and houses fair asunder, they were far away, the houses were situated far away, but he ne left not for rain no thunder. He did not care for the he did not care for any rain or any thunder, for any type of bad weathers. He did not spare himself in that, in sickness nor in mischief to visit the farthest in his parish, mush or light, upon his feet and in his hand a staff. A staff means a stick. So he would carry a stick in his hand and upon his foot he would visit all the rich or poor people who were who had their houses in the farthest parts of his parish. He would visit them. He would not give any sort of excuse that this was the reason that he could not visit them. Neither rain nor thunder, nothing could stop him, not even his sickness, not even his illness could stop him. He never made any sort of excuse to avoid these visits. This noble ensample to his sheep he yef. Sheep refers to his subjects, the people who were under his control, so the town men. So he would give this noble example to his men, that first he wrought and afterward he taught. He first he would set an example for them and later on he would teach them, this is how you are supposed to behave. So this, he is a good clergyman. That is why he would set the example and he would practically do the things in the way the people are supposed to do, so that people observe him and they believe that whatever he is saying, he is right because he does the same. Out of the gospel he though words caught, and this figure he added thereto, that if gold rust, what shall iron do? So he took a phrase from the gospel, he took those words and he added probably to it, that if the gold rusts, if it is not valuable, what shall iron do? Iron usually rusts. So he basically compares, here it's basically the comparison, that if the clergymen who are in charge of all these things, who have to direct the people towards the religious path, if they are rustic, if they have rusted, if they are not good, if they are not doing good deeds, what will the people do? So it is the good example here, that if the people who are involved, who are the first hand receivers of that knowledge of gospel and Bible, if they are not acting upon it, if they are not practicing it, how will people do that? If you yourself are not following, how would you preach the people? How would you teach others? For if a priest be foul on whom we trust, no wonder is a lewd man to rust. Lewd is the ignorant, that if a priest is foul, he is corrupt. People usually trust the religious people, that okay, fine, he is, since he teaches, he is a religious person, so he knows all these religious matters. So if that person practically does not implement those teachings, whatever he is preaching, how would that ignorant man believe in that, whatever he is saying? So no wonder is a lewd man to us. So how would he believe that? And shame it is if a priest take keep a shitten shepherd and a clean sheep. So he says that it is a shame that if a shepherd, if it is a shepherd and he is dirty, he is foul, and the sheep are clean. So for him, since he is an ideal character, he believes that the clergymen, the religious people, have to set an example first in order for the people to follow it. And later on preach them that this is how you are ought to behave and this is how you have to live in the society. So he is a true religious person. So this is, again, we have a person who is an ideal character. Ideal in the sense that he is doing what he is supposed to, or he is leading the life in a religious manner. Well ought to priest and sample for to give by his cleanness how that his sheep should live. So he is giving, well ought a priest and sample, that a priest is supposed to give the example how to live by his cleanness, how that his sheep should live, that the priest should set up an example that how people should lead their life. He set not his benefice to hire, he did not get any benefits out of this, and let his sheep encumbered in the mire, and ran to London unto Saint Paul's to second him a chantry for souls. To second him is to get to look for himself. So say here, once again, it's the reference to St. Paul, St. Paul's Cathedral, basically, which is situated in London. If you set an example first, he had set an example for the people to follow that, and he had not taken any benefit out of it. He has not taken any benefit, and he let his people to observe him and to take that example, and he did not and he ran to London unto St. Paul's. So it is the reference to St. Paul's Cathedral that he did not let his people to run to London to St. Paul's Cathedral to get for themselves the confessions and the chantries for their souls, or with a brotherhood to being withhold, but dwelt at home and kept well his fold, so that the wolf ne made it net miscarry. He was a shepherd and not of mercenary, and though he holy were and virtuous, he was to sinful men net despotous. Despotous is merciless. He was not merciless to the people who were guilty of sins. So he believed in the brotherhood. He believed in the brotherhood of the guild, that all the peoples of the society, that all the people who are living in the society, they are equal, and miscarry is go amiss, that you leave. And he was a shepherd and not a mercenary, that he was a shepherd, he was not a missionary. So he was, though he was virtuous and he was true to the teachings of the Bible, he was not merciless to the people who were guilty of sins. Nay of his speech dangerous, no dying बट इन हिज टीचिंग डिस्क्रीट एंड बिनाइन टू ड्रॉन फोक ऑफ हेवन बाय फेयरनेस बाय गुड एनसेम्बल दिस वॉज हिज बिजनेस एंड इट वर एनी पर्सन ऑब्स्टिनेट वट सो ही वर ऑफ हाई एंड लो स्टेट हिम वुड ही स्निबन शार्पली फॉर द नॉनेज. In his speech, he was not assertive. He would teach very discreetly and in a very kind and pleasant manner. And he would draw people to the heavens by the through the fair means and by setting the good example, by setting his own example. So this was the way he was busy. That he tried to call people. He tried to attract people through his speech by teaching them. He set an example first, and then he preached them the teachings of Bible, the teachings of gospel. So if there, but on the other hand, it was for the people who would listen to him. But on the other hand, if there was anybody who was obstinate, who would not agree, who would not listen to his preachings, no matter whatever his rank, whether he belonged to a higher social rank or he belonged to a low status of the society, he would very straightforwardly snub the person for doing this nonsense. So he was very fair in his dealing with the people. The ones who would listen to him, who would follow his preachings, he would be kind and pleasant to them. On the other hand, if somebody is obstinate, he did, or no matter whatever the rank of the person, he would still remain fair to the person and he would snub the person for doing the bad things. A better priest, I trow, that nowhere known he is. True belief. So he waited after no pomp and reverence, nay made him a spiced conscience, but Christ's lore and his apostles 12 he taught, but first he followed it himself. Now the narrator believes that a better priest cannot be found anywhere like him. He waited after no pomp and reverence. He expected no show off, no respect. He did not demand that. He did not expect any kind of show off or respect. He had a good conscience and he believed in the Christ's preachings and his 12 apostles, and he taught. So how did he spend life? He followed the Christ's gospel and his 12 apostles. He taught people, but before teaching them, he practically practiced those preaching. After that, because he presented a role model to the people, and then he preached that this is how you are ought to behave. With him there was a plowman, was his brother, that had a clad of donkful many a father. A true swinker and a good was he, living in peace and perfect charity. God loved he best with all his whole heart. At all times, though him gamed and smarted, and thane his neighbor right as himself. So there was a plowman also with him. He was the parson's brother. And plowman is basically a small landowner. This small landowner or a small farmer. This small farmer is usually an independent farmer. He is not serving anybody, because when we talk of yeoman and we talk about the other people, they are under the service of the king or some other people who supervises them. But in the case of a plowman, he is an independent small farmer. He might pay some part of his earnings to the king, but he is an independent farmer, a small farmer. And he was carrying lots of cartload, and he was a true hard worker, and he was a very good fellow. He was living in peace and perfect charity. He loved God the best all his in his holy heart. Why holy heart? Because he is a very simple man. He worked very rarely, very hard, and he gave charity also. At all times, though him gamed and smarte, gamed and smarte. At all times, he was no matter he was hurt or he was he had been gamed. That if somebody robbed him or somebody did bad to him, even if he was hurt, he at all times he would be good to his neighbors, and then his neighbor right as himself. He would love them, he would regard them, or he would respect his neighbors as he respected himself. He would thresh and dare to dike and delve. For Christ's sake, for every poor wight, withouten hire, if it lay in his might, his tithes paid he full fair and well, both of his proper swing and his cattle. Now, the ploughman, what he did, he could dig the earth, he could dig the ditches, he could dig the earth also. For Christ's sake, for every poor wight, for every poor man, whosoever was in need of him, he would ask him, without getting hired, he would do his work. If it is, it lay in his might, if it was in his reach, if he had power to do the thing that he could, he would go for it, no matter even if the poorest person comes to him and asks him for help, he would go for it. चाहे वो उसको ना भी पे करे, कोई भी अगर गरीब आदमी भी उसके पास आ जाएगा तो वो उसके साथ उसकी हेल्प करने के लिए चला जाएगा, और जो भी काम वो उसको कहेगा वो उसको कर देगा बगैर हायर किए हुए. हिज टिदेज, अगेन द 10th पार्ट ऑफ द इनकम दैट इज टू बी पेड फॉर द वेल बींग ऑफ द सोसाइटी, फॉर द पुअर पीपल. पेड ही फुल फेयर एंड वेल, ही वेरी फेयरली एंड सिंसेयरली पेड द टिदे, ही पेड दैट 10th पार्ट ऑफ हिज इनकम फॉर द बेटरमेंट ऑफ द सोसाइटी. बोथ ऑफ हिज प्रॉपर स्विंग, प्रॉपर स्विंग इज द हार्ड वर्क दैट ही इज डूइंग इन द फील्ड. सो जो वो खुद काम अपनी मेहनत से कर रहा है, जो वो फसलें, जो क्रॉप्स उगा रहा है, उसमें जो उसको अर्निंग हो रही है उसका 10th पार्ट, एंड हिज कैटल, और जो कैटल में भी जो इंक्रीज हो रहा है, जो भी आगे फ्लरिश कर रहे हैं उसके कैटल, दोनों का 10th पार्ट वो रेगुलरली और बहुत सिंसेयरली ऑनेस्टली वो पे कर रहा है. इन अ टेबर्ड ही रोड अपॉन अ मेयर. टेबर्ड इज द इन, मेयर इज द horse. So he rode upon the mare. There was also reeve and a miller, a summoner and a pardoner also, a municipal and myself. There were nemo. Nemo means no more. So the rest of the characters that he is going to describe, they are the reeve, the miller, the summoner, the pardoner, the municipal, and the narrator who is narrating this whole, who is describing all these characters. The miller was a stout calf for the nones. The miller was a stout means a chubby, a fat fellow. Calf, a countryman. Nones means for once that he had lived in the countryside. He was a fat fellow, countryman who had lived, who had once lived in the country. Full big he was of brawn. Brawn means his muscles. They were, he was, he had well built muscles, an eke of bones, and also of bones, his muscles and bones, they were well built. That proved well, for over all there he came. At wrestling he would have always the ram. So he would always come with a prize in a wrestling contest. He was short shouldered, broad and thick near. There was no door that he gnarled have of hair, of break it at a reining with his head, his beard as any saw or fox was red. So now a bit of his description. He was short shouldered, broad and thick neared. There was no door that he gnarled have of hair, and break it at a ringing with his head, his beard as any sow or fox of reed. Sow is a pig. So his beard was as a pig or a fox. Like the his beard was red, just like the color of a pig or a fox. And there to brood as though it were a spade. So he was broad as if it was a spade. Upon the cop right of his nose he had a vertae, and thereon stood a tuft of hairs. read as the bristles of a saw's arrays. His nostrils, black, were and wide, a sword and buckler bar he by his side. So what he was wearing, first his facial features that he had at the top right of his nose, he had a mark, he has a sign there, and there stood some hair on it. The bristles of his ears, they were red, and his nostrils were black and wide. A sword, he was heavy, carrying a sword by his side. He was having a sword and a shield also. He was carrying a shield and a sword. His mouth as great was as a great furnace. So his mouth was as big as a furnace. He was a jangler and a gladys. Jangler is a talker and a gladys is a buffoon. So he was both. He was a kind of chatterbox who would speak all the time, keep on talking and talking and talking. So he was a jangler, and that was that he would not keep quiet, and that was most of sin and harlotries. So he would that was the reason of his sin and his jests. He would keep on making cracking jokes all the time. Well could he stellen corn and tollen thrice. Tollen is take. So he could steal the corn and he could take the thrice, and yet he had a thumb of gold pardie, a white coat and a blue hood wared he, a bagpipe well could he blow and swan, therewithal he brought us out of town. So a bit of his outer appearance, that he was wearing a white coat and a hood also and a bagpipe. Bagpipe is an instrument that is used, that is played for sound. And by playing the instrument, you would call the people from the town. He said that when they wanted to call all the pilgrims, he would blow his instrument, he would play his instrument in order to bring the people out of the town. A gentle municipal was there of a temple. So there was a municipal, there was a butler also, of which assetors might take example. So the buyers would take his example, because he was very wise and he was very careful in his dealings. For to be wise in his bang of by tail, for whether that he paid or took by tail. So whether he paid the money or he took it from someone as debt, elgate he waited so in his a chat, that he was a buffoon and in good state. That no matter what type of dealing he has, whether he took money from someone or he gave it to someone, he was very careful in his dealings, and he was very careful in his dealings, and he took proper care of everything beforehand, and it was in good state. It was a good habit of his. Now in that of God, a full fair grace, that swish a lewd menace which shall pace, the wisdom of an heap of learned men, of masters had he more than thrice ten, that veron of law expert and curious, of which there were a dozens in that house. So these lines basically explain his mental power, that all those learned men who were present there, they had wisdom, but this person, he excelled them all in this skill, and he was an expert of law, and he would, dozens of the people who were present there in that place, in that temple, then he might surpass them if all the wisdom of all those people, if that is collected, he would surpass them all, he would outnumber them, he would excel ahead of them. ही वॉज सो स्किल्ड इन हिज क्राफ्ट, इसको इतनी महारत थी इस आर्ट में कि जहाँ जितने लोग वहां पर मौजूद थे अगर उन सब की विजडम को भी इकट्ठा कर लिया जाता तो ये उनसे आगे निकल जाता है, वो इसको मात ना कर सकते हैं। वर्दी टू बी इन स्टेवर्ड्स ऑफ रेंट एंड लॉन ऑफ एनी लॉर्ड दैट इज इन इंग्लैंड। Now see, he was a worthy steward. Steward is basically the manager of a large state, a capital. So in England, any lord could take him, could hire him as the steward for the rent of his land. To make him live by his proper good in honor, debtless, if he were would. Or live as scarcely as him less desire and able for to help in all a shire in any case that might fall or hap and yet this mansible set her aller cape. Now what happened? He was a capable man. He had this skill that he could be taken as a steward by some lord in England because he could manage things very well and so that the lord can live his life properly so that his property would be managed very well by him and he would live the life of honor without any debts. And in this way, he is able to help all the shire, the whole state, the whole country. And in any case that falls, he can befool them all. He can befool all the people present there. He is such a clever and sharp-witted person. The reeve was a slender, choleric man. Slender is slim, is a thin man, a weak man. Choleric is the ill-tempered, somebody who gets angry very quickly. His beard was shaved as nigh as ever he can. He did not have a beard, it was shaven. His hair was by his ears, full round ye shone, that they were all cropped. His hair were all cut around his ears. His top was docked like a priest buffoon. His top was decorated like a priest in front. Full long were his legs and full lean. He had long legs and they were very thin. He like a staff. He carried a stick also. There was no calf seen. No flesh was visible. He was so thin and a very smart person, a very slim person that no flesh of his was. He like a staff, there was no calf seen. So here the poet is using simile that it looked like a skin. He was so thin, he was so slim that it looked like a skin and no skin was visible, no flesh was visible. Well could he keep a garner and a bine. There was noon auditor could on him wine. Well wiste he by the drought and by the rain. The yielding of his seed and of his grain, his lord's sheep, his neat, his dairy, his swine, his horse, his stool and his poultry. So he could keep the things very well. He could keep the granary and the bin, and he had been a very good auditor also, and he knew even in drought or rain he could manage equally well, and he could yield his seeds and grain also. He could manage all these things very well, and he could manage even the lord's sheep. He could manage his cattle, his dairy, his pigs, his horses, his store and his poultry. So he could manage all these things very well. So basically this is concerned with his skill. He was a skilled worker that he could manage all these things at the same time. Was wholly in his reeves governant and by his covenant yef the reckoned. Sin that his lord was 20 years of age, there could no man bring him in arrearage. Their nest, belief, no herd, nor other hind, that he ne knew no his light and his coven. So it was a kind of, was holy in his reeves covenant. There was a kind of contract given to the accountant. It was said that his lord was 20 years of age and no man on earth could bring a debt to him because he was so skillful in his work. No other person, no matter whoever is serving the person, his lord, he knew the his deceit. They were adread of him. Adread is afraid of him as of the death. They were so afraid of him as people are afraid of death. His wing was full fair upon his head. With green trees, ye shadowed was his place. He could better than his lord purchase. Full rich he was, astored poorly. His lord well could he pleasant subtly. Now, it describes his the place of living, that where he was living. He was they were afraid of him as they were afraid of death, and he was living on a place. It was like a heath. It was like a garden. It was all covered with the green trees, and his lord could better purchase that land. It was full rich. And he had poorly stored all the riches, all the necessities of life in that, and his lord could well pleasantly do that. He has provided all the necessities of life that poorly, and his lord would be pleased to know that. To give and lend him of his own good, and have a thank, and yet a coat and hood, and youth he had learned a good master. He was a well good wright and a carpenter. This reeve sat upon a full good stort that was all pomely grey and height scot. So again, to give and lend him of his own good, for his own good he could, and have a thank, and yet a coat and hood. So he was wearing a coat and a hood, and in his youth he had learned, he had good teachers in his youth, and so he had learned from them. So he was a well good wright, a carpenter, so he had a lot of skills. So the reeve sat upon the horse, which was in good situation, that was in good position, and it was gray, and he sat on it high, and it was called, or its name was Scott. A long surcoat of purse upon he had, and by his said he bare a rusty blade. Of Norfolk was this reeve of which I tell. Beside a townman Clapham Boldswell, Turked he was, as is a frere about. And every he rode the hindrance of our route. So he was wearing a blue long. He was wearing a blue purse is blue, and surcoat is the upper coat. See, so he was wearing a blue long upper coat, and on his side he was carrying a rusty blade. So it was probably used again and again. It was used a number of times, so it was rustic, and it was used probably in his youth time, but now it was not used, so it has become rusty. He had come from the north of the country. The narrator says that the person, the reeve about whom I'm telling, he is from north part of the country. Besides the townman, he is called the Bledswell. So he was stuck like a friar, and he also rode on the way like a hindrance. So there were a number of characters today. If we have a recap of the lecture, we find that we had a number of characters. We had the shipman, the character sketch of a shipman, because since he takes people from one place to another, so he was also a little bit corrupt, because he also made his way of getting his benefit wherever he could. Then we had the doctor of physics, who was not only the doctor of medicine and surgery, he was skilled in his art of astronomy also, and he took help from both the field of physics, medicine and surgery, and the astronomy. Then we had the wife of Bath. She had been to a number of shrines because she loved traveling and she enjoyed in the company of people. After that, there was the parson. The parson is a very religious person who spent his life according to the teachings of the Christ. The plowman is there, who is the parson's brother. He very fairly paid the 10th part of his income, both from the cattle and from the land also. The miller. Finally, we had the miller. Then we had a bit of the description and the interests of the miller. And the, finally, it was Reeve. In the next lecture, we will have a little description of the rest of the characters, probably it's the summoner and one more, and then finally we will have a discussion of all these characters. We'll compare them, that how they are different and what are the characteristics that they share with each other, because there are certain characteristics like the people belonging to the church and even some of the ordinary people also, their physical description is also given, and the kind of armaments that they are carrying, they are also important. Their description that guides us, the type of dress they are wearing, that gives an insight into the character sketches of these pilgrims. So in the next lecture, we'll have the rest of the remaining characters and description and the comparison of these, that how they are different. Kis tarah se ye log ordinary life ko bhi realism kis tarah se depict kiya gaya, because when we compare these characters, we come to know that some of the characters, they are, all these characters, they are true to life. Wo जैसे हकीकत में होते हैं वो बिल्कुल उसी तरह से हैं. कुछ अच्छे हैं, कुछ जो है उनके इंटरेस्ट जो है वो वर्ल्डली इंटरेस्ट हो चुके हैं, वो मटेरियलिस्टिक बन चुके हैं. इस दुनिया में आके उनको मादियत उनमें आ चुकी है, तो इसलिए उनके उनकी अप्रोच लाइफ की तरफ डिफरेंट है, उनका गेटअप डिफरेंट है, वो जो चीज़ें उनके पास हैं वो डिफरेंट हैं, उनके आर्मामेंट्स डिफरेंट हैं, उनके लाइफ स्टाइल डिफरेंट है. इन द नेक्स्ट लेक्चर वील हैव द कंपेरिजन ऑफ डिफरेंट कैरेक्टर्स ऑल्सो. Allah Hafiz.